excelsis Deo. Domine, gratia, semper et preveniat, et sequatur, ad bonis operibus iuditer prestet esse intentos. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum, filium tuum, qui tecum vivere regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti, Deus per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
The Lord God will wipe away the tears from every face. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, "Behold our God, to whom we look to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice in the fact that he has saved us, for the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain."
Verbum Domini.
Deum gratias.
Verbum
gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Verbum gratias.
Lectura de la carta del apóstol San Pablo a los filipenses. Hermanos, yo sé lo que es vivir en pobreza y también lo que es tener tesoro. Estoy acostumbrado a todo. Lo mismo a comer bien que a pasar hambre. Lo mismo a la abundancia que a la escasez. Todo lo puedo unido a la tierra que da me da fuerza. Sin embargo, han hecho ustedes bien en socorrerme cuando me vi en dificultades. Mi Dios, por su parte, con su infinita riqueza, remediará con esplendidez todas las necesidades de ustedes. Por medio de Cristo Jesús, gloria a Dios nuestro Padre, por los siglos de los siglos. Amén. Al verbo Domine.
Te deo gracias.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Matteum.
Gloria a Tui, Domine.
Jesus again in reply spoke to the chief priests and the elders of the people in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the feast, but they refused to come. A second time he sent out other servants, saying, 'Tell those invited, behold, I have prepared my banquet. My calves and fatted cattle are killed, and everyone is ready. Come to the feast.' Some ignored the invitation and went away, one to his farm, another to his business. The rest laid hold of his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged and sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy to come. Go out, therefore, into the main roads and invite to the feast whomever you find.' The servants went out into the streets and gathered all they found, bad and good alike, and the hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to meet the guest, he saw a man there, not dressed in a wedding garment. The king said to him, 'My friend, how is it that you came in here without a wedding garment?' But he was reduced to silence. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind his hands and his feet and cast him into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Many are invited, but few are chosen.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Well, good afternoon. We just have a few announcements. Today's Mass is being offered for Lucille Maloney. And also, through the generosity of one of our families, we'll be able to provide coats for our children again this year. So if your family could use a little help buying coats for your children, please sign up in the entrance area. We're going to have the event next Saturday at 7:45. So just sign up out in the entrance. Si necesita ayuda para comprar abrigos para tus hijos, hay un formulario para inscribirse. Es un evento el próximo sábado a las 7:45 de la mañana. The next part of the St. Celia Society recital series is October 29th at 3:30 p.m., so it'll be a Sunday at 3:30 p.m. One of our own parishioners, who's an internationally accomplished pianist, will be playing pieces from Bach, Schubert, and Liszt. And it's a free will offering. There's no charge for the event. You just donate whatever you like. So that's going to be the 29th. Our bishop, hay un recital del piano el 29 de octubre a las 3:30 de la tarde. Es uno de nuestros feligreses, que es un pianista que es conocido internacionalmente, no sé si es correcto o no, en todo el mundo. Internacionalmente, ¿es una palabra? Ah, oh, perfecto, okay, so that's what it is. Our bishop asked, and also the patriarch of Jerusalem has asked that we observe a day of fasting and prayer this Tuesday to end the war and the violence in the Holy Land. So este martes es un día de ayunar para paz en la Tierra Santa. So please, if you can, fast and pray on Tuesday. Our religious education program for children with special needs begins next week. It begins next week. So el programa para los niños que tienen necesidades especiales va a comenzar en la próxima semana. Si requiere más información, puede llamar a la oficina. Also tonight we have Youth, Junior, and Children's Oratory. Esta noche es los grupos del auditorio para los niños. So how's everybody doing? Are you still with me? Did you fall asleep during all those announcements? No? ¿Está durmiendo todos? No? Okay, bueno. Okay, last week the brothers, if you remember, the brothers shared with us a little bit about how God called them to the oratory. And if you were able to go to the different masses, you'd notice that each of the brothers, Brother Anthony spoke, did you speak at this mass? Well, somebody else spoke. So if you went to the different masses, you'd hear a different story from each of the brothers, you know, and they were completely different. If you asked Father Nick, or me, or your brother Don, you would get six different stories about how God called us the oratory, because God isn't calling robots, he's calling people, right? We all have our own personalities and dispositions, and God calls us with our own personalities and the things that we like and enjoy and all of that. And that's how God works. God calls us individually first. That's how he begins all the great works that he does in the world. And the call of each person, no matter what God is calling us to, is a call that's not just for itself. It also affects others outside of ourselves. So those of you who are called to marriage, you have your children, right? And so the effect of your vocation to marriage is felt in the life of your children, and it'll be felt in the life of your grandchildren and great-grandchildren and great-grandchildren and great-great-grandchildren. I don't know, maybe you'll see them. I don't know. But anyway, it'll be felt. It ripples out. Any vocation that comes from God ripples outside of the individual. Our vocations are not just meant for ourselves. And we see this, and this is how God has worked from the beginning, calling individuals to do his work in the world. We see it from the first call of Adam and Eve, our first parents. God created them to be in a relation with one another and established a marriage covenant with them and made them the father and mother of all of humanity. So God begins with the call of a couple, right? Just a couple. That's how the whole world began, with two people, Adam and Eve, with one couple. Even science says that now, that there was one original man and one original woman. And after the fall, you know, because remember Adam and Eve, what happened? They ate from what they weren't supposed to eat. You know, they did something wrong. And so, you know, God could have washed his hands of them and said, well, forget it. That was a bad experiment. I'm not going to do that again. But he doesn't do that. He doesn't give up on us. He seeks again to reach out and to save us. But yet, even though he does that, with every succeeding generation, humanity gets more and more depraved, worse and worse and worse, until the point where God looks out at the world and he can only find one righteous, one good man left. Anybody know his name? I'll give you a hint. He built a big boat. Noah, right? He looks out and he finds that only Noah and his family are still righteous and trying to live a good and holy life, because that's the way Noah had raised them. And so God saves his family and makes them the new beginning of a new humanity. And he establishes a covenant with Noah and his family. So now we went from a covenant with one couple to a covenant with a family. And so, which leads us to the next great covenant with Noah's great, 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 great grandson. Anybody know his name? I'll give you a hint. It ends in Ham. Abraham. Excellent. Very good. Abraham. And Abraham was a chieftain, a tribal leader of a small tribe in the Middle East. And the covenant that God made with Abraham, now this is a little bit of a review from our Old Testament series, right? I'm just going to go real quick because you've heard this already. But the covenant that God made with Abraham had three promises. God promised that the descendants of Abraham, that they would inherit a land of their own, that his descendants would become a royal nation, and that they would be the source of a blessing upon the whole world. So this covenant now is with one holy tribe. So we went from one holy couple, one holy family, now one holy tribe. And God reveals to Abraham a few things. First, that he tells him, your descendants are going to be enslaved in a land not their own. But God says to him, don't worry, I'm going to free them and give them their own land, like I promised you. And historically, we know that that's what happens, right? The Jewish people get enslaved in Egypt. So then God calls somebody else to rescue them from their slavery. Do you remember his name? Moses, right? If you've seen the Prince of Egypt, you know, or the Ten Commandments, I think, with Charlton Heston, you know that it was Moses. And so God calls Moses to rescue his people from slavery in Egypt and to make of them a holy nation. So from a holy couple, holy family, holy tribe, and now to a holy nation. And this nation is built upon the families and descendants of Abraham's 12 great-grandsons. These descendants are grouped into the 12 tribes of Israel. So the 12 tribes of Israel are all the descendants, the children and grandchildren and nieces and nephews, all that, of these 12 sons of Jacob, Abraham's grandson. Once they are in the land that God promised to them, God then grants them a king. Anybody know his name, the great king of Israel?
David,
very good, King David. And now they're one kingdom. So from one couple to one family to one tribe to one nation, now to one kingdom. But there's one part of this of the covenant that is not fulfilled. One of the things that God had been talking to them about and promising them throughout the covenants and throughout the time of the prophets, and that was that Israel would be a blessing upon the whole world. Well, we know from history that Israel eventually gets conquered, right? The north gets conquered by Assyria, the south gets conquered later on by Babylon. And so from that time on, the kingdom of Israel no longer exists. It doesn't exist today. The state of Israel is not the kingdom of Israel. The two things are two completely different realities. One was a kingdom established by a covenant with God. The other is a secular, democratic state in the Middle East. But they're not the same. So once the kingdom was destroyed, how was it that God was going to fulfill this promise that Israel would be a blessing upon the whole world? Well, it's through one of the great, 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 lots of greats, grandson of Abraham. One of the other great, 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 great grandsons of Abraham. And his name is?
Jesus,
right? Jesus is the eternal Son of God, but also a descendant of Abraham through his mother Mary and his adoptive father, Saint Joseph. And Jesus begins something new, and yet organically grown from the ancient covenant that God made with his people. He calls 12 Jewish men, who are also great, 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 lots of greats, grandsons of Abraham. And these 12 represent the 12 sons of Isaac, who are the fathers of the 12 tribes of Israel, which made up the kingdom of Israel. And so Jesus is trying to show us through these 12 apostles that he's establishing a new Israel, a new kingdom, and that is the church, the Holy Catholic Church. So it went from one couple to one family to one tribe to one nation to one kingdom to one Holy Catholic Church. Are you still with me?
Yep.
Everybody with me? Great. And this church founded by him is no longer attached to an earthly kingdom or a land, but is universal in nature. It calls to the hearts of people from every race, culture, and way of life. Its arms are outstretched. And if you look at the world today, is there a single culture on the face of the earth that has not heard the name of Jesus? No. The message that God wanted to share through the Jewish people, through the church, is now spread to every place on the face of the earth. The children of Abraham have become a universal blessing through the gift of the establishment of the church by Christ. So you see, the church isn't just an accident of history. It was what God had in mind from the very beginning. In fact, the early Christians used to say that the church was the very reason that God created the world in the first place. That's pretty powerful, right? That from the moment that God created the earth, that he had the church in mind. So from one holy couple to one holy church. And like the parable that Jesus tells in today's story, everyone is invited to the banquet of the church. Nobody is excluded. But though everyone is invited, you have to come to the wedding banquet dressed properly. Now, he's not talking about, you know, because what happened to the one that wasn't dressed properly for the wedding feast? What did they do to him? They tied him up and they threw him out. Well, Jesus isn't talking about what the clothes that we're wearing. We're to be dressed with righteous and good deeds and love and self-sacrifice, a love that is striving to live in the way that he's taught us to live. Dressed with repentance when we fail to live in that way. This is how we get dressed for the wedding banquet to which everyone is invited. Because although everyone is invited, not everyone will be able to remain. Next week, we'll continue with the series, with, and we'll talk about the four marks of the church. Now, just a little bit, just a little synopsis in Spanish. De la Sagrada Escritura, podemos ver que Dios estableció su primera alianza con una pareja, la primera pareja, Adán y Eva. Con ellos, Dios estableció las raíces de la humanidad y la civilización y casamiento. El casamiento. Y Adán y Eva llegarían a ser el padre y la madre de toda la humanidad. Así que la primera alianza fue con una pareja. Luego, después de la caída y de años y años en los que el hombre se volvió más malvado con cada generación, Dios estableció una nueva alianza con una familia, la familia de Noé. Y Dios salvó a esta familia del diluvio y los convirtió en el nuevo comienzo de la humanidad. Y más tarde, Dios hizo un pacto aún mayor con Abraham, el líder de una tribu, a quien Dios prometió que sus descendientes tendrían su propia tierra, se convertirían en un reino y algún día serían una bendición para todo el mundo. Así que ahora la alianza es con una tribu. Esto sucedió a través de Moisés. Dios da a los descendientes de Abraham su propia tierra y hace su alianza ahora con una nación. Con cada pacto, el cerco del pueblo de Dios se hace cada vez más amplio. Entonces Dios levanta a un rey, el rey David, y hace su alianza con David. Ahora es un reino único. Pero con todo esto siempre faltaba algo. ¿Cómo iban a ser una bendición para todo el mundo si no existía más el reino de Israel? Eso sucede a través de Jesús, quien elige a 12 apóstoles, todos descendientes de Abraham, para dirigir su iglesia. El número no es una casualidad. Los 12 simbolizan las 12 tribus de Israel, los descendientes de los 12 hijos de Jacob, el hijo de Isaac y el nieto de Abraham. Y vemos a través de la historia que este nuevo Israel, la iglesia, se extiende por todo el mundo y el mundo entero es bendecido a través de la familia de Jesús, la iglesia. Como ves, desde el principio Dios creó el mundo teniendo en mente la iglesia. De hecho, los primeros cristianos decían que la razón misma por la que Dios creó el mundo fue para la iglesia, para tener la iglesia. Y esa iglesia que está extendida por el mundo y llama a todos los hombres y mujeres al banquete es la una santa iglesia católica. La próxima semana continuaremos con nuestra serie sobre la iglesia. ¿Quiénes somos como iglesia? So next week we'll continue with our series on who are we as the church.
Credo in unum Deum.
Pare unio tenem, fato
et in
Christo.
Patris, umem ac est un sacrificium acceptabile, fiat apo Deum Patrem omnipotentem.
Suscipiat Dominus sacrificium humanibus suis, ad laudem et gloriam in nomine sui, ad utilitatem quoque nostram, totisque et fede sancte.
Suscipe, Domine, fidelium precis, cum oblationibus ossiarum, ut per ec pie devotionis officia, ad celestem gloriam transiamus, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et spiritus tuo.
Sussum corda. Gratias sigamus Domino Deo nostro. Benedignum eius tu mes, tacum et salutare. Nos tibi semper et ubique gratias agere. Domini Sancte Pater omnipotens eterni Deus, per Christum Dominum nostrum, cuius hoc merificum fuit opus per fiscali mysterium, ut peccato et mortis jugo ad hoc gloriam vocaremur. Qua nunc genus electum regales sacerdotium, gens sancta et acquisitionis populus diceremur, et tuas annunciaremus ubique virtutes, qui nos et tenebris altum admirabile lumen vocasti, et ideo cum angelis et cacangelis, cum tronis et dominationibus, cumque omni militia celestis exercitus, imnum gloriae tuae canimus sine fine jicentes. Sanctitatis, ec ergo nequesmus spiritus tui rore sanctifica, o nobis corpus sanguis fiat, Domini nostri, Iesu Christi. Qui compassione volontarie te redetur, accepi panem, e gratias angens fregit, dedique discipulis suis dicens. Accipite et manducate ex hoc omnes, hoc est enim corpus meum, corpo vobis tradetur. Simili modo, postquam tenatum est, accipiens et calicem, iterem tibi gratias angens erit discipulis suis dicent. Accipite et bibite ex eo omnes, hic est enim calis sanguinis mei, Novi et eterni testamenti, qui pro vobis et promotis et fundetur, in remissionem peccatorum, hoc facite in mem commemoratione. Mysterium Fidei. Resurrectionis eius, cibi Domine panem vitae, et calicem salutis offerimus, gratias agentes qui nos dignos abuisti, estare coram te tibi ministrare, et supplices te peccamur, ut corporis et sanguinis Christi participes, a Spiritu Sancto congregemur in uno. Recordare, Domine, Ecclesiae tue toto ore refuse, ut in incaritate perficias, una cum Papa nostro Francisco, et Episcopo nostro Davido, et universo claro. Mementum etiam fratum nostrorum, quins per resurrectionis dormierunt, omnium qui in tua miseratione defunctorum, et eos in lumen vultus tui admite, omnium nostrum quismus miserere, ut cum beata Dei Redemptrice Virgine Maria, beato Iosef et Sponso, beatis apostolis in omnibus sanctis, qui tibi a saeculo placuerunt, aeterne vitae meriamur esse consortes, et te laudemus et glorificemus per filium tuum, Iesum Christum. Per ipsum ecum ipsor in ipso, est divideo Patri omnipotenti, nunitate Spiritu Sancti, omnis honor et gloria per omnia saecula saeculorum. Salutaribus moniti et divine instruzioni formati, ademus dicere, Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuam, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra, panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et imite nobis de vita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem, se libera nos a malo. Libera nos quesmus, Domine, ab omnibus malis, dano propitius patrem diebus nostris, ut opi misericordiae tuae adiuti, et a peccatus simus semper liberi, et ab omni perturbatione securi, expectantes beatum spem, et aventum sanctoris nostri, Iesu Christi. Domine Iesu Christi, qui existi apostolis tuis, patrem linquam vobis, patrem meam de vobis, Ne respicias peccata nostra, sed fidem ecclesiae Tue, e amque secundum voluntatem Tuam, pacificare et coadunare igneris, qui vis renas in saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo. Ecce Agnus Dei, ecce qui tolle peccato mundi, fiati qui acenem advocati sunt.
Domine,
nostrum minus, potentere sub tectum meum, se tantum dic verbo et in abitur anima mea.
Oh.
Oremos. Majestatem tuam, Domine, supplicite, deprecamur, ut sic nos corporis et sanguinis sacrosancti facie alimento, ita divine natore facies esse consortes, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum. Benedica vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Deo gratias.